Pop quiz, let's test your scientific acuity. Which of the following concept aliens do you think is the most plausible? First, this one. Okay, how about this one? And this one? This one? And this one? Have you picked one already? Now finally, how about this one? Alright, the answer will follow later in the video. You probably noticed a lot of them were humanoids. Humanoids are sentient creatures that resemble our own species, Homo sapiens, in most respects. In science fiction, they're a very popular way of depicting intelligent aliens from outer space. But how likely is it that evolution in biospheres far away from Earth's would end up with basically the same results? Let's attempt to find out. Humanoid aliens are the staple of contemporary science fiction, but why? Why would we expect creatures evolved on another world to look just like us? Well, for starters, the only ones that we know the existence of are humans themselves. It is very hard for us to imagine beings at our own level that are not in some ways or in most ways similar to ourselves. However, already as early as 1695, renowned Dutch physicist Christiaan Huygens reasoned that rational beings existing on other worlds may have some things in common with us, like having hands, feet, and an upright stature, but that is where the similarities would end. In many other aspects, he stated, they could be very different indeed, like for example having fur or feathers, or even an exoskeleton, as unappealing as that may be to us humans. Yet, the idea of aliens being just like humans persisted into modern days. Novelist Edgar Rice Burroughs, especially known for creating Tarzan, envisioned Martians along those lines in his 1917 novel A Princess of Mars. With it, he laid the foundation for science fiction in literature as well as movies and TV series. But there is also a more down-to-earth reason, pun not intended. For early TV series like Star Trek, it was fundamentally about budget and lack of technology. It's a lot easier to make actors look alien with some minor cosmetic tricks than to create elaborate suits and special effects. But perhaps most importantly, humanoid aliens allow the audience to relate to the characters. That is also why science fiction invariably features humans as main protagonists. Like for instance Luke Skywalker, even though he and his kind cannot possibly be human. Star Wars is set a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, and we know for a fact that human beings evolved naturally on our own planet. So the humans in Star Wars, or whatever passes for humans, must be entirely unrelated to and coincidentally be indistinguishable from humans. In the many billions of galaxies in the known universe, what are the odds of that happening?
Never tell me the odds.
How likely is the genesis of an alien race almost genetically identical to earthly humans? By looking at our DNA, could we simply calculate the odds? Well, the number of coding genes in the human genome is about 20,000. The letters of genes are formed by nucleotides, of which there are four natural varieties. In humans, the coding part of the genome contains about 3.2 billion base pairs in total. So, the likelihood of creating an identical sequence randomly is 1 out of 4 to the power of 3.2 billion. This is an insanely high number that is practically infinite. Now, the number of stars in the entire universe is estimated at 10 to the power of 19, so even if we assume one habitable planet for each star and a million trillion random sequences being generated each year over a period of 15 billion years, the age of the universe, we would never even come close. So is it just impossible? Well, in reality, this calculation tells us very little about the actual odds of evolving a humanoid being. Let me explain. An entire genome isn't generated randomly, but has evolved as a result of natural selection. And expecting the exact same DNA sequence can be very misleading indeed. DNA holds information about proteins, which in turn determines what cells do. Proteins are made out of chains of amino acids, each encoded by three successive nucleotides, in so-called codons. Now there are many codon synonyms, and there are also many non-functional sections of proteins where it doesn't matter what exact amino acids are used. So a lot of genetic differences would still lead up to the exact same proteins being produced. Generally speaking, DNA can differ to up to about 34% and still give the same results. But we can relax the required DNA sequence many times further still. Many proteins have specific aspects just to be able to interface with other proteins in a so-called gene regulatory network. So the only thing that really matters are the protein end products, as well as the timing of their production. The intermediate proteins can be very different themselves. But even the exact same proteins can in principle be encoded in entirely different ways. The translation of a gene to a protein is mediated by a molecule called tRNA, which determines what combination of base pairs becomes what amino acid in the protein chain. This can be represented in a translation table and appears to have been arrived at arbitrarily during the earliest stages of the evolution of life. In other words, the translation table for Earth's life was frozen at a primeval stage, allowing for only minor deviations between the different lineages. Life on other planets could have their own distinct translation table, so if you would put their DNA in our cells, they'd not give the same results at all. In addition, a lot of similarities at the molecular and biochemical level could already be taken care of by convergent evolution. There may be only a limited set of molecules that does something useful for life, or there could also be many alternatives that do the same. In the latter case, you would not even need the exact same biochemistry to end up with something looking very much alike. Just like how operating systems may look very similar even when running on very different hardware. So, we don't get a lot out of analyzing our DNA. In any case, any possible humanoids that are genetically similar to our own species somehow are a subset of a much larger group that are not. And since on Earth there is only one group of species that is humanoid, that could mean that there is an even larger group of sentient aliens that are not humanoid. Or does it? What if the humanoid body plan really is the only sensible way to make a technology-using species? Would sentient aliens be expected to have arms and hands like us? Would they then naturally stand upright? Would they then even likely have a head too? Let's look at those questions by breaking down the basic human body plan and trace down the evolutionary origin of each element. This will be the first of an entire video series covering human anatomy to assess how unique or common all of its different aspects may be. That way, we can perhaps get some idea of how likely it is that it may evolve independently in some other branch of life somewhere else in our galaxy or beyond. So how about that quiz I started out with? Well, it was a bit of a trick question. In reality, each of these aliens is equally plausible. That is because we are comparing specific manifestations, each with their own unique evolutionary history. Now, comparing broad categories like humanoid, reptilian, or insectoid is a different case. But without a survey or catalog of different life forms in the universe, we have no statistics to base the odds on. And without statistics, we can only make educated guesses. Still, if one were to ask how likely the humanoid category of alien beings is, then I think the answer is, out of all the conceivable options for sentient life, probably not very common. But what do you think? Just leave a comment below. We may learn more in my upcoming videos, so stay tuned. Thanks for watching and bye-bye.